south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
All right, back in the saddle again. Missed last show because I had a little trouble in Bogota, Colombia, would you believe? First time in the history of all my travels, and I've been through 3 passports now, all stamped out. At least that's the history of my U.S. passports. And this is the first time ever that an airline has lost my luggage. Now, I'm not saying I haven't been robbed a few times. Small things, like a few Swiss Army knives, watches, cheap watches, that is. I don't use watches anymore. Hey, we only have about 11 things on our body that tell time these days, right? That's why I think anyone who's sporting one of those Patek Philippe or Rolex or any one of those expensive chronographs is just, well, a pretentious show-off. In fact, I remember the ex-president of Guatemala, Alfonso Portillo, a real crook who stole a lot more than the next guy, who did 5 years in prison in the U.S. He had an expensive watch collection of over 50 watches worth $750,000. A real man of the people, huh? And you know what's funny about that? Have you ever been to a gambling town like Vegas or Atlantic City? They've got those pawn shops. You look in the window, there's like 75 Rolexes in there. And the owners? Pawning their Rolexes? Pretentious dickheads, all of them. But for Latinos moving on up, man, you just hit one of the upscale shopping malls and you will see Rolexes. Who knows if they're fake or not? I'm certain most of them are. And those idiots sporting them, they'll make sure they're wearing a shirt that's 2 sizes small so that sleeves and cuffs are automatically jacked up so that Rolex is in full view. There are some people in life that just need to get slapped. And then there are those certain guys whose mug you see in the media all the time, born with a kisser only a mother could love. Remember George C. Scott and Carl Malden and, of course, Pete Townsend of The Who? They had kind of more nose than face. Hey, but they had talent, so they did all right. And then there's those guys with a face only a mother could love that have no talent at all but made it to the top. People with a face that's not exactly homely, but yet you want to slap. And in a more caveman-like world, they wouldn't be around anymore. Like, for example, and he's the perfect example, Mark Suckaturd, which kind of explains the look on his face, don't you think? But I digress. Man, this early in the show and I'm digressing already? So anyway, the airlines lost my luggage from Panama to Bogota, had some of my recording gear in there, and it eventually showed up but a couple days late. So in a way, you really have to hand it to the airlines. I mean, really, I've taken hundreds of air flights, and only once have they lost my baggage, but they found it. And about getting stuff swiped out of your luggage, well, you know, the baggage handlers know every trick in the book. And those cheap-ass cracker box zippers and locks, man, they're of no use at all. Besides, they're made so the TSA can crack them open in 3 seconds. Luggage locks? What a joke. But then again, you can always have your stowed luggage shrink-wrapped for like 10 bucks, right? Something I never do because often, up to the last minute, I get a kid in there and rearrange things. And if your luggage is shrink-wrapped, forget about it. And why, pray tell, would I have to rearrange things? Well, because sometimes I'm carrying heavy stuff. And with a stowed bag, they only allow up to 23 kilograms, about 45 pounds. And if I'm overweight, I can just pull a little something out of there and put it in my carry-on, and I'm back within the limit again. Otherwise, it's a $50 to $100 surcharge. You know, airlines are strict on the stowaway luggage weight, but they're oh so lenient when it comes to carry-on, as long as the size is within the requirements. It could be well over the usual weight of 22 to 25 pounds. No one seems to care, and rarely do they ever get weighed. So I don't shrink wrap my stowed piece of luggage, but I do carry a roll of packing tape, you know, that clear stuff that's so strong. And I do run about 10 turns of that packing tape around my stowed luggage. It's not exactly hermetically sealed, but it's a great deterrent. All you really want to do is secure the zippers and pockets because baggage handlers are pretty rough. I've watched them, and they don't seem to like their jobs much. Like my mother always said, beware of people who don't like their jobs. That'd take in maybe 80% of the world, huh? Oh, and the second reason I use packing tape on my stowed luggage is to deter the baggage handlers from swiping valuable stuff, which you really should be putting in there anyway, but hey, one man's smartphone's another man's doorstop, right? Anyway, back in the saddle again, doing this show from, guess where? Medellin, Colombia. I thought I'd take a swipe through for a little while since so many gringos have been piling into the district of Poblado. That seems to be gringo heaven. And that's exactly where I am right now. And it's, believe me, so cosmopolitan. And since all the retirement rags, blogs, and international living are all pushing Medellin, especially the district of Poblado, they're calling it the latest, greatest gringo expat retirement destination along with Cuenca, Ecuador. Well, today I thought I'd give you the good, bad, the ugly, and the great about Poblado, just in case you're planning on going there. First, I have to tell you that Medellin, and in fact all of Colombia's most famous citizen, is not Shakira, nor Juan Valdez. Boomers, you remember that guy? Juan Valdez? Johnny Valdez? Old ranchero mountain guy with a big old sombrero sitting on a donkey in the coffee fields? We'd see him promoting coffee day in and day out on Boomer TV. Well, he's still around, or the ghost of him is still around, but you know whose ghost is alive and well? It's Pablo Escobar, but the city fathers of Medellin surely don't publicize that. He's the black eye they don't want you to look at, even though there have been movies, TV shows, crime reports, dozens of books written about the guy, but no official publicity. Even though the most popular tour in Medellin, in fact of all Colombia, is a tour of Pablo Escobar's haunts, digs, and many homes. But you won't see that in any of the official tourist rags. But ask any cab driver or man on the street and he'll know. In fact, the most famous piece of tourist junk in Medellin, Colombia are Pablo Escobar t-shirts. Or specifically, Pablo Escobar t-shirts with the FBI wanted poster printed on them. And it says, there's a $2 million reward for information leading up to the arrest and capture of Mr. Escobar. So when you're in Medellin, you can certainly spot a tourist a mile away. He or someone in his group will have a Pablo Escobar t-shirt or coffee mug. Now, you've heard me mention a number of times in a past show that Medellin, Colombia, and Colombia in general is becoming first world expensive. Well, that's true in the gringoized areas. That's what always happens. But here's what you didn't know. Even food in the big markets is two, even three times as expensive as it is in Central American big produce markets. For example, I was just pricing out mangoes yesterday. They've got these big dinosaur egg-sized mangoes that you can get up in Guatemala or Salvador, even the Dominican Republic, in season for around $3 to $5 for a buck. Meanwhile, in Colombian food and produce markets? Well, when you're in the big city, and Medellin's a big city, about 4 million. And Bogota, 10 million. Bigger than Chicago or New York. So then how many of those big mangoes could you get for a buck? Try one. If you're lucky, two. And if you get two, they won't be as big as dinosaur eggs. Oh, and I ran into a neat scam when I first arrived at the Bogota and then Medellin Airport. You see, in Colombia, about 99% of the places will not take U.S. dollars, including taxis. Of course, there are money-changing persons and kiosks, and your hotel will change your money, but for a crap rate. For example, right now it's 3,300 Colombian pesos to the dollar at a bank or ATM. But in your hotel, even a very nice first-world hotel, you'll get 2,500 to the buck. If you do the math, you'll see your hotel is skimming 25% off the top. 25%. At least the money-changing kiosks on the street and at the airport will give you 3,000 to the buck. They take about 9 or 10%. That's a pretty stiff skim, too. But now, here's the airport scam. Like I said, taxi drivers resist taking U.S. dollars, which is why they have so many money-changing booths and ATMs at the airport. So you get off the plane, you go to one of the official money changers, kiosk, you know, in the airport or in the ATM, and let's say you just changed 100 bucks and you got 300,000 pesos. Remember, at the bank and the ATM, you'll get 330,000. And they'll give it all to you in big bills because that's what you want, and it's a pretty even number. The big bills in Colombia being 50,000 peso notes. That's about 16 or 17 U.S. dollars. Now, the normal taxi ride from the Medellin airport to the city, to Poblado, that's the gringo district, is about 75,000 pesos. That's close to 25 bucks. And of course, you don't have that in exact change, so you'll give him 250,000 notes and he'll give you 25,000 back, right? Well, that's the scam. Taxi drivers can spot a gringo in a second, and not just because he can't speak Spanish. And in the mix of your change, he'll slip a 20,000 peso note that's a counterfeit. But of course, how's a tourist in a foreign country going to know that? The same thing just might happen if the cab driver accepts your dollars. Let's say you give him a 50. He'll give you 25 bucks change in pesos, and you'll be glad to get it because you don't have any of the local funny money. That's where you just might get slipped a counterfeit or two. Especially if your plane comes in at night, where people coming in are all worn out and frazzled from layovers and lines and TSA. loose bowels, lump in the stomach from that pre-digested airplane food. You know what a travel day is like. And when you arrive at 11, 12, or 1 in the morning, hell, you just want to get to your hotel or any hotel, or jump in the shower, or maybe skip that and go straight to bed. So for late arrivals at airports, that's when the counterfeit money scam works best. Now, once you get out of the doors of the airport, there is no official place to change money. But there are always guys hanging around who will do it for you. My suggestion, don't bite, because you'll be ripe for the scam there, too. Now, I'm not saying all those guys are scammers, but there are enough stories going around that I wouldn't take the chance. All right, another thing I noticed in Bogota, Medellin, and really all over Colombia, except Cartagena, because it's really just a gigantic beach town. You'll find Colombia is by far cleaner than any of the Central American countries you'll visit. For one thing, they're more educated, more college degrees, they care more about the environment, and cleaning up their own backyard. Or maybe it's that they put more money into garbage pickup. Well, you know, all you have to do is go to a big city like Cleveland or Chicago, into the Latin district, and you'll see where all those bad habits came from. Mostly Central Americans, not South Americans. And, you know, Chile, Ecuador, and Argentina have higher standards of cleanliness, too. The people seem to be just much more tidier. So, yes, I'm more than willing to stereotype Central Americans, including Mexicans. They're probably worse than any. They don't give a rat's ass about keeping their own house in order. Hey, that reminds me of a joke a really good Mexican friend of mine told me way back in high school. He said, how can you tell a rich Mexican from a poor one? The rich one's got two cars up on blocks in the driveway. All right, that calls for a pregnant pause. Sure, there are always picky Central American outliers that are clean freaks, but I certainly haven't met many of them. But I'll tell you, it's true, and I dare you to come down to South America yourself. They really seem to have developed higher standards than their Central American counterparts. So the old saying, poor folks have poor habits, only works, it seems, for Central Americans, with the exception being Brazil. Brazilians are pretty damn scruffy. They belong right in the same stereotypical bracket as Central Americans as far as cleanliness and order. But, you know, it's a completely different culture because their original roots were Portuguese. So, for example, even the lower middle class scruffy neighborhoods in Colombia are nicer than the lower middle class scruffy neighborhoods in Guatemala, Honduras, Panama, El Salvador, Mexico, even Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic. And another thing, in Colombia, they spend a lot more money on road repair than they do in any of the countries in Central America or Mexico. Now, compared to Central America and Mexico, unless we're talking about a new road, more often than not, there are gaping holes and manhole covers missing. That's why I advise, don't drive at night. Oh, what's that I hear from the peanut gallery? You can't say manhole cover anymore? Well, I challenge you to come down and look me in the eye and say that, and I'll do a Mo Howard eye poke on you. Oh, and here's another thing. Just in the last month, the floodgates of pissed off Americans have opened. I'm getting emails like crazy from people saying, Johnny, I've had it up to here. I got to get out of the U.S. And my answer, what the hell took you so long to getting around to getting that plan B going? You know, every day it's getting worse and worse. I hate to say I told you so. So I won't, but I did suggest at least 1,000 times that you got to get that plan B going. But back to the good, bad, ugly, and the great in Colombia, specifically Bogota and Medellin. Now, as mentioned, they're a society that's much more educated than Central Americans in general. The Argentines are too. The Brazilians right next door. Nope. They're largely stuck 30 or 40 years in the past, educationally speaking. So then as far as Medellin and Bogota, the places you and other gringos might want to live, work, play, and or hang out, well, they've got some fantastic brand new malls that are practically cities in themselves. And amazingly enough, you'll see that the women and most of the guys are almost always in style. In talking to some of the locals down here, you'll find, just like you find up in Central America, most of the women and men spend all their dough on clothes and discos. Of course, it's a lot easier to do because most Latinos under 30 live with their parents. But it's true, here in Colombia, they really do look sharp. In Spanish, it's called la moda, the mode, or the fashion. And man, do Colombians, especially the girls, know how to dress. But here's the thing. In Central America, the clothing market, for ladies mostly, is saturated with items coming from China. You know the deal, right? Got the same thing up in the States. Even though there are hundreds of clothing maquilas throughout Central America, the fact is those clothes end up being shipped to the States and the locals can't afford the real designer labels. So they buy the Chinese knockoffs. Now, as for South America, specifically we're talking about Colombia, they've got the lower-end districts and lower-end malls where you can get the Chinese stuff, but in the middle class and upper middle class malls, there's a surprising number, in fact, a huge number of clothing stores and outlets with just some really fashionable clothes and accessories that are made right there in Colombia. And they say right on the door, hecho in Colombia. In fact, you know, those famous Colombian women hourglass figures are responsible for most of the reason why they wear clothes made in their own country, because the Chinese stuff that comes in is made for North American and European bodies. As you know, certain Latina body types don't much exist up in the States. Meanwhile, in the last year or so, I've been doing a poll, a kind of a subjective body style survey, because people are always asking me, who are the most beautiful girls in Latin America? What countries and cities are they located in? Now, I ask you, who better to put together a survey like that but yours truly? I'd go to a coffee shop in a mall or outside of a busy business district. I'd look at body types logically, like an engineer would do. Now, we all know what a full-figured Latina woman looks like. You know, Sofia Vergara, even half of J-Lo, the bottom half. You get the picture. What I've been doing off and on now for about a year now, I've been traveling quite a bit. I'd count the average-looking girls as they went by, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on, until one of those hourglass, full-figured girls walked by. You rarely see that body type up in the States, so they're easy to spot. As it turns out, about every 15 to 20 Colombian ladies had a Sofia Vergara-type extreme hourglass figure. The reason I'm bringing this up now, because you don't know how many emails I have in the archives from guys saying, Johnny, where can I find the most beautiful, shapely, voluptuous, yada yada. So anyway, about 3 months ago, I did the same thing in Panama. Sat down in Panama City, coffee shops, malls and stuff, and did the count. Now, remember, all girls and guys have their beautiful and not so beautiful parts, so I wasn't looking for pure beauty. I'm just looking for the so-called Colombian-style hourglass figure. Now, in Panama, it seemed to average out about one in every 20 to 25 ladies. Now, you have to know what I'm talking about. That tiny little waist, big bust, big butt. Let's put it this way. You wonder where they can find clothes to fit a figure like that, and how they ever manage to fit into those jeans. They must A, either have a personal tailor, and believe me, that's not the case. They don't make that kind of money. Or B, buy clothes made in Colombia, where the market is. Now, in this little straw poll, I've been taken through various countries. Now, remember, this study is in the interest of science, only after I received many, many curious emails from gringos and even a few gringas. So it did take a lot of emails for me to start this endeavor with any kind of seriousness at all. Now, where were we? Oh, yeah, and I'm not delineating whether these ladies came by those extreme hourglass figures through genetics or they've been artificially pumped up. My job as an impartial observer is to check the facts and the figures. Mostly the figures. Tough job, but someone's got to do it, right? And it's true. Here in South America, anyway, there's a whole lot of surgeries going on. Mostly, if not exclusively, on the payment plan, too. Because, and here's another thing that's hard to believe, since the people are so well-dressed, you wonder how the average person could get the dough to do that, since the minimum wage in Colombia and most of South America is pretty much exactly the same as the minimum wage in places like El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, Dominican Republic, etc., around $300 a month, maybe a little more. The question is, how do the ladies and even the guys dress in fashion on that kind of salary? Much less get a little lipo on the side, or more likely, in the front. Well, again, it's good old credit card debt. Everyone's maxed out. However, unlike up in the first world, people don't seem to be too stressed out about it. And people working at the banks here will tell you almost no one's got anything in a savings account. Sound familiar? So, bottom line, if you're thinking about Bogota or all-time gringo favorite, Medellin, as compared to doing your plan B in Central America, the roads are nicer and cleaner, way less garbage, a lot fewer road hazards and potholes, and in general, a much more cosmopolitan style of living. But it comes at a price. For example, if you want to buy a really nice two-bedroom apartment, let's say 1,200 square feet, those things are 200 grand and up. There's a real estate bubble for sure. Mega construction going on because they're expecting all the gringos and Europeans to flock in continuously like they're doing now. Here's something you'll never read about. I've been staying in a couple of high-rise hotels and Airbnbs on upper levels, and I've noticed something almost no one's talking about. There seems to be an extreme shortage of rooftop solar panels and rooftop solar water heaters, etc. In fact, just yesterday afternoon, I took a 360-degree survey of the rooftops from a rooftop gym on an 8-story building, and I couldn't find one single solar panel. And I was looking at hundreds of buildings and houses. And of all the hundreds of storefronts I walked past in business districts, I didn't see one advertising solar or solar power. And I'm thinking, what the hell's going on over here? It's got unlimited amounts of sun. I mean, Colombia. The equator goes right through the southern part of it. And you've got the two biggest cities, Bogota and Medellin, at 4,000 feet and up elevation, so they're considered in their own small altiplano. So you've got perfect weather and intense solar radiation because the air's thinner at higher elevations, yet no solar. And I'm thinking, what the hell is wrong with these people? Then I thought, you have to go back to the source. About 80 to 90% of all solar panels are made in China, designed in the States usually, but made in China. And as mentioned before, containers are coming from China every day with goods, but they haven't completely taken over the market like they have up in the first world and in Central America too. In any event, there's a huge opportunity for anyone who wants to get into the solar business down here because, you know, electricity is not cheap anywhere in Latin America. It's much more expensive than up in the States, except where it's subsidized and socialized. That would be Cuba and Venezuela. And of course, having the government own your electrical utilities means you have equal opportunity power outages too. Lots of them. Now, talking about the good, bad, ugly, and the great, here's another problem. If you own a car in Bogota or Medellin, you're only allowed to drive it every other day because they've got so much air pollution going down. Actually, the cars and trucks are in very good condition compared to Central America. You almost see no junkers on the road. But you see, both of those cities are in a bowl surrounded by mountains, so pollution builds up fast. But the drivers are just as crazy as they are in Central America. In fact, within 1 hour, I saw two accidents, a semi wiping out a passenger car, and something I've never seen before, a taxi hitting a pedestrian, I mean hard. That certainly bollocksed up things on the road for an hour or so. Oh, and another thing I noticed about Colombians. With all their newfound wealth, social climbing, and fashion sense, they don't seem to be quite as happy as the poorer people you see in Central America. In fact, it seems they're less excitable, less likely to break out into laughter or sing or tell jokes on street corners. Who knows why that is, but I was with two people from Panama. And both of them made the comment that the only place Colombians get a little wild and crazy is at night at the discos. Whereas in Panama and most other medium and large cities in Central America, you'll see people on street corners laughing, hugging, slapping each other on the back, telling jokes, with music virtually everywhere, blaring out of cars, storefronts, houses, everywhere. Don't get me wrong, the Colombians love music. They're just more civilized about it. And believe me, the girls can dance, and the guys too. It just seems like they, Chileans and Argentinos, seem to be a little bit less spontaneous than Central Americans. It's funny, too, that in Latin America, the higher the education level seems to be, the less happy. It's as if the more education you have, the bigger your treadmill. Here's another thing about Colombia. They are totally dog-friendly. I mean, you can go to any mall or any store and see people walking their dogs, on leashes, of course, and very clean and well-behaved, too. Not just poodles and chihuahuas, either. I've seen some big ones. Now, I'm talking about seeing dogs in middle and upper middle class malls. I don't know about the low-end malls. I doubt it. Because, again, poor people have poor habits. And poor people with dogs, well, that means dogs more or less will do what they want. And you can't have much of that in a shopping mall. And related to that, I saw something for the first time in all of Latin America. A Latino male picking up his dog's poo. Oh, I'm not talking about in the shopping mall. Saw dogs, but no poo there. Like I said, those middle and upper middle class shopping malls are spick and span. Speaking of shopping malls, I happen to be standing in the doorway of Forever 21. You know, that's everywhere, right? Forever 21. Just when you think you've seen everything. I saw two Catholic nuns in there checking out the clothes. Yep, I got a picture. Talk about liberal. Does the Pope know about this? Well, who knows? We've all heard stories about nuns having something on the side. I mean, hell, priests do it. Who knows what goes on beneath those flowing robes? I can only imagine. On second thought, better not. But I digress as usual, though not too much since lingerie does tie into that stereotypical concept of the curvy hourglass Latina shape. So I was talking about my unofficial straw poll analysis of which Latin countries have the curviest girls with the best hourglass-shaped figures, or the greatest percentage of hourglass-shaped figures. Well, you know, I've been putting together data for some months now, and here's my tally, my breakdown. The Latin country with the highest percentage of curvy hourglass figures by far, Venezuela. By my count, sitting in the malls, cafes, business areas, mostly off the gringo tourist trail, almost exclusively off the tourist trail, I'm seeing about 1 in 10 or 12 Venezuelanas with that kind of shape. But you know, in the mind of a first world gringo or gringa up in the States who only sees women like that on TV or in beauty pageants or in the media, you think the percentage would be a lot higher. That's something like 7% of girls in that age category. Like I said, just giving you the facts and figures here. And then we've got the Latin country that comes in a close second. Take a guess. Dominican Republic. Now, in addition to the fact that in the Dominican Republic, they've got some of the greatest hourglass shapes in the world, there's that extra little spice of a touch of African descent. So the girls come in all colors and hairdos, too. Whereas in Colombia and Venezuela, the stereotypical girl with the hourglass shape is almost always light-skinned and much more European-looking. Of course, the hairstyles and shapes are all over the place these days because, well, girls like to change up all the time. It's interesting. I found the only other country besides Dominican Republic where the guys and gals come in all rainbow colors and natural hairstyles is Brazil. However, you longtime listeners know I don't recommend Brazil to live, play, work, and or retire. All right, as for that straw poll of the girls with the hourglass shapes, country number one, Venezuela, number two, Dominican Republic, number three, Colombia, number four, Panama, and of course, Brazil. As for the other 15 Latin countries, they're not even in the running. All right, so there you have it, my personal superficial analysis of extreme Latina body types, the analysis undertaken by popular demand. And I mean popular. Oh, and let's touch on the subject of high maintenance. Used to be, according to a lot of my friends, when Venezuela was on the up and up and oil was booming, 15, 20 years ago, most of my friends, both gringo and Latino, who had gone to Venezuela and found themselves in the mating and dating game. Well, back then, they found the ladies there very high maintenance, but not anymore because the country's in the crapper. And you know, that affects people's standards. Now, however, since Colombia is booming, same thing. Everyone I know, both gringo and non-gringo, who find themselves in the middle of the Colombian mating-dating game are crying high maintenance, especially if they found their mates on Colombian Cupid sites. But admittedly, high maintenance in Latin America is nothing like high maintenance up in the States. All right, we're getting towards the end of the show now, and I expect to get a poop load of hate mail. Well, bring it on, ladies. Just remember, the name of the show is The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, and we'll touch on everything and anything that has to do with living, working, playing, and or retiring. And that will include sometimes talking about offbeat subjects that you won't hear anywhere else. For example, how is it that some Latin ladies have body parts that seem to defy gravity? Is it real or is it Memorex? You've been listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, we can schedule a one-on-one phone or Skype consult. Just send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. And if you want to get on the waiting list for my next week-long Expat Insider Seminar in Central America, where you're guaranteed to get a 2 to 5 year head start on your Plan B, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. Nos vemos.